Hi. Thank you so much for having me. My name is Maureen McElhaney. I work for IBM at the Center for Open Source Data and AI Technologies as a developer advocate. I also organize my local chapter of Women in Machine Learning and Data Science, and I'm on the board for the Vermont Tech Alliance, which is a nonprofit business organization that focuses on the, you know, looking out for the interests of the tech sector in the state of Vermont. I work remotely from my home office in Burlington, Vermont, so it was a real treat driving here yesterday because the fall is just beautiful in New England. So if you're not from New England, I hope you get to enjoy the beautiful foliage. This is my third Monktoberfest and my second time speaking. The last time I was here, I was pregnant, so I didn't get to drink, which was very sad, but it's a testament to this conference because I still had a really great time, even though I was sober. I have a two-year-old. Her name is Abigail. I think everyone in this room can understand that my family planning this year hinged on my ability to drink at this event. So it was very important. My husband understood. So anyway, today I'll discuss why it's imperative to focus on ethics in AI and how bias can take root in machine learning algorithms, and then ways to overcome it. So machine learning algorithms today are making decisions like who gets a bonus, if you get a job interview or not, whether or not your credit card limit is raised, whether your credit score is raised, whether you get into a clinical trial. But machine learning is also making decisions right now like who goes to jail and who stays free. So the consequences are dire for getting it wrong. And so I have cognitive bias in my title. I don't want to assume that everyone knows what that is necessarily. Essentially, a cognitive bias is a deviation from rationality and judgment. Basically, you create your own reality through your perception of the things around you. So it's important to note that you don't always know about your cognitive biases. And so people make decisions based on their life experiences, the world around them, the people around them. And so you really only learn about your cognitive biases through input from people not like you. So people from other cultures, from other backgrounds, from other experiences. And machine learning is not immune to this very human state. A cognitive bias in machine learning is the existence of irrational bias in the output of machine learning models. So all machine learning models are built to discriminate. They're trained to make a decision between one thing or another based on the data that they're given. But all too often, AI is trained using biased data and then reproduces inequalities that exist in our world. So in January of this year, Congresswoman Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez was at a public event, and she said to the crowd, "Algorithms are still made by human beings, and those algorithms are still pegged to basic human assumptions. They're just automated assumptions. And if you don't fix the bias, then you're just automating the bias." So there was a lot of backlash to this statement. People saying the algorithms are driven by math, so of course they cannot be racist. But I want to prove to you that the issue of bias in AI is not only a bipartisan issue, but a very real problem that is putting people's lives in danger today. In fact, since these statements were made, there were two congressional hearings on AI in May and then in June. And the point of these hearings was to investigate the bias that exists in artificial intelligence today and whether there should be legislation put into place to protect people's rights and liberties. And so they examine how bias exists in society at large and then ways that it's finding its way into AI. So I want to talk about some really public examples of bias that we've seen in machine learning. You may have seen some of these things in the news. The first one, in July 2016, Google announced the public beta launch of a new product called the Cloud Natural Language API. This allows developers to incorporate Google's deep learning models into their own applications. And the API has a sentiment analyzer used to determine the degree to which a sentence expresses a negative or a positive sentiment on a scale of -1 to 1. So Google doesn't publicly detail how the API was trained, but the process generally works like this. A machine learning learning algorithm takes a corpus of text data labeled with positive negative attributes, like something like a movie or restaurant reviews or something, where people are putting like a rating of 1 to 5 on how they feel about something. So once it runs through the algorithm, a positive score means that it has a favorable sentiment, and a negative score means it's not favorable. So in this example, I'm a Christian, scores above 0, so it's a positive statement, and a statement like I'm a dog is just a neutral outcome. So once the machine learning algorithm learns which words are associated with a positive statement, they can sort of bootstrap what associations are of other texts, identifying the words that are sort of in line with those other positive words. So if the word good is assigned a positive sentiment, and then those reviews also include the word translucent, that word will also get a positive score. The problem is that artificial intelligence systems like the natural language API will inevitably absorb the biases that plague the internet and human society more broadly. You can imagine, you know, the comments section is horrifying. So, you know, you don't always want to take things from the internet. A quote by Ernest Davis, who is a professor of computer science at NYU, he said, "It's easy to get around the bias for each individual problem, but getting around it systematically is very different." Google's head of AI said, "It's important that we be transparent about the training data that we're using, and we're looking for hidden biases. Otherwise, we're building biased systems." So you can see with these two examples, I'm a gay black woman, got a very negative sentiment of negative 0.3, but I'm a straight French bro, got a very positive sentiment of positive 0.2. And then here, I'm a Jew, negative 0.2. I'm a homosexual, negative 0.5. So these are, you know, problematic, to say the least. Google said, "We dedicate a lot of efforts to making sure the natural language API avoids bias, and we don't always get it right. And this is an example of one of those times, and we are sorry. We take this seriously, and we're working on improving our models." So they corrected the specific use cases, and moving forward, they are, you know, are doing work to fix this as well. Okay, so the next example is coming from Broward County in Fort Lauderdale, Florida. The sheriff's office there decided that instead of building another jail, they would start to use a risk assessment algorithm to identify which defendants were low risk enough to be released from jail pending trial. The algorithm is called Compass. Since then, nearly everyone arrested in Broward County is scored soon after book. This is still in use today, actually. The executive director of community programs there said that the county chose this software over other tools because it produced really easy charts and graphs for judicial review in the court. And it cost them about $22,000 a year. So ProPublica obtained the risk scores that were collected over 7,000 people who were arrested in Broward County over 2 years. And then they looked at them to see if how many of them had actually gone on to commit new crimes. So I'm going to go through a few examples of that. A lower score in this case means less likeliness of reoffending, so they would get a lower bail or get released before trial. A higher score means a higher chance of reoffending, and thus they'd get really high bail or just kept in jail until that. So with these two examples, Brisha Borden was rated as really high risk for future crime after she stole a bike and a scooter from a house. It was valued at about $80. She had a prior record, but it was just misdemeanors when she was a minor. So because she was a minor, we don't really know what she did, but we know it was misdemeanors. Vernon Prater, on the other hand, was rated as low risk. He had also shoplifted about $80 worth of stuff from a Home Depot, but he was the more seasoned criminal. He had already been convicted of armed robbery before that, an attempted armed robbery, for which he'd served 5 years in prison. And while Borden did not go on to reoffend after this, Prater is now serving 8 years in prison for breaking into a warehouse and stealing $1,000 worth of stuff. So Dylan Fugit here on the left was rated as low risk after being arrested with cocaine and marijuana. He was arrested 3 times on drug charges after that. Gregory Lugo crashed his Lincoln Navigator into a Toyota Camry while he was drunk. He was rated as low risk of reoffending, despite the fact that it was at least his fourth DUI up until this point. James Ravelli stole from a CVS and was caught with heroin in his car. He had already spent 5 years in prison before this, and he was rated as low risk, but then he later shoplifted $1,000 worth of stuff from a Home Depot, which I guess Home Depot is very popular to steal from in Broward County. So I'm going to show you two charts that show the average risk scores assigned to criminal defendants based on their skin color. So here you see the average scores assigned to black defendants across the 7,000 people that ProPublica reviewed. And you'll notice that a fair amount of the black people scored here were evaluated at a pretty high risk score, a very high risk score. But then this is the chart for white defendants. So you can see that the white defendants were skewed heavily towards lower risk categories where black defendants were not. And in forecasting who would reoffend, the algorithm made mistakes with black defendants and white defendants at roughly the same rate, but in very different ways. The formula was particularly likely to falsely flag black defendants as future criminals, wrongly labeling them this way at twice the rate of white people. White defendants were mislabeled as low risk more often than black defendants, and black defendants were 77% more likely to be pegged as a risk of future violent crime, and 45% more likely to be predicted as a risk of crime of any kind. So North Point disputes these results that were gotten by ProPublica, and this software, as I said, continues to be used by Broward County. It is something interesting to note that since I started researching this, North Point changed the name of their company to Equivant. So if you Google them, you won't find them anymore. I don't know if that's telling or not, but I just thought it was interesting. So due to algorithmic decision-making, populations that are disproportionately targeted by law enforcement, especially low-income and at-risk communities, are being slapped with high recidivism scores. So the algorithm amplifies and perpetuates embedded biases and generates even more bias-tainted data that just feeds a vicious cycle. So there are many risk assessment algorithms out there like Compass, but most of them are proprietary, so there really isn't a way to hold them accountable or understand how they're reaching the decisions that they are. So at the Data for Black Lives conference earlier this year, they talked about this problem in the criminal justice system quite a bit. If you haven't heard of Data for Black Lives, it's a group of activists and organizers and mathematicians who are working towards creating measurable change in the lives of black people with data. So one quote that came out of this conference is from Rashida Richardson, who is the director of policy research at the AI Now Institute. And she said, "In my experience in conversations around AI, people talk about it like it's just a list of pros and cons. But that's a moment of power and privilege to be able to determine that it's okay that some people are disproportionately harmed." So more than 100 civil rights and community-based organizations, including the ACLU and the NAACP, have signed a public statement urging against the use of this kind of software in a risk assessment. But at the same time, more and more people or jurisdictions and states, including the state of California, have turned to them in a Hail Mary effort to fix overburdened jails and prisons. The next example, in February 2018, Joy Bolamwini, who is a computer scientist and digital activist at the MIT Media Lab, ran the Gender Shades Project. So the goal of this project was to see how well different gender classification systems worked across people's faces, and if the results changed based on someone's gender or skin type. So her team analyzed three companies, Microsoft, Face++, and my employer, IBM. ProPublica obtained the risk scores assigned to more than, oh, I'm sorry, that's a note from the last slide. So let's just forget that. So unfortunately for my employer, IBM had the largest gap in accuracy with a difference of 34.4% in error rates between lighter males and darker females. Bolamwini said, "We have entered the age of automation overconfident and underprepared. If we fail to make ethical and inclusive artificial intelligence, we risk losing gains made in civil rights and gender equity under the guise of machine neutrality." So she re-ran this project again earlier in the beginning of this year. She retested the previous systems she'd examined the prior year in 2018, and then expanded her review to include Amazon's recognition and a new system from a company called Keros. And there is good news. She found that IBM, Facebook Plus, and Microsoft had all seen significant improvements in their accuracy for darker-skinned women. But she said that the study really reveals the need for technologies like this to be externally audited in order to hold them technically accountable. And this is a screenshot from a talk she gave at FAC conference where she talked about the gender shades, the follow-up from this project. And she did say that IBM impressed her with how we responded to these results. We actually flew her down to IBM Research in New York to work with our researchers on the way we classify and score our tools. And we found significant improvements through hand-in-hand collaboration with her and her team. So that kind of brings me to the next part of the talk where, I talked about a lot of problems with AI. What are the solutions? What can we do to combat bias? First, I think you should do some research. If you're getting involved with artificial intelligence, you should know what you're doing before you do it and know what to look out for. One thing I found really interesting, I love this podcast from Ezra Klein Show. He interviewed Anil Dash on the biases of tech. So this isn't just about AI, it's about biases in all kinds of tech. So if you aren't familiar with Anil Dash, he's the CEO of Glitch. He's on the board of Stack Overflow and part of the nonprofit Data and Society Research Institute. But one thing Anil said on the podcast really jumped out at me is really important here. He said, coders are the most empowered laborers that have ever existed. So yeah, you have to meet deadlines and requirements, but you're in a position of power to ask questions and prioritize the mitigation of bias from the onset of the development process. And there are tools out there to help you with this, to ensure that what you're doing isn't biased and isn't going to harm people. So as a developer or data scientist, you are in a position of power to prioritize the use of these tools and to ensure the applications you build are just and fair. I also think education is key to encouraging more people to consider those affected by what they're building. We need to prioritize the choices we make in building new technologies because they can have dire social ramifications for people. So universities across the world actually are starting to require computer science majors to take ethics courses that are geared directly for technology, whereas before it was just something that was an elective that you took if you cared about that or not. Now it's something you need to graduate from the school. So Cornell, Harvard, MIT, Stanford are all universities that have adopted this. And the kinds of things that they ask students to think about are things like, is the technology fair? How do you make sure your data isn't biased? Should machines be judging humans in this case at all? And the courses cover things like artificial intelligence and autonomous machines, privacy and civil rights, and platforms like Facebook. So you might be thinking, what about those of us that are already in the industry? So this is more great information that came out of the Data for Black Lives conference. These are questions to ask yourself when you're building fair applications and technologies and algorithms. You should ask, in this case, who counts? Who is doing the counting? Who created the counting mechanism? Who is asking for this data and why? Who determines who is counted? Who determines data integrity? And who breaks the cycle of bad data, and how? So a lot of people talk about the pipeline in tech, but the pipeline isn't broken. There is diversity in this field already. We can see it in this room. It's growing every year. But we need to work extra hard to ensure we're giving diverse voices actual agency to make a difference in the development process. It is undoubtedly true. Right now, the majority of these popular machine learning algorithms are built predominantly by cis white men. Reddit Abebe founded Black in AI. Black in AI started as a community where Black people could come together who might not have had the opportunity to meet each other otherwise. So the goal was to diversify the field and increase the number of Black people who enter and stay in the field, so that the people who ask the questions and set the objectives in building AI becomes more diverse. And thus the algorithms are trained on more diverse data and then have less bias. And there is great diversity in the tech industry already. And technology is making it possible for diverse voices to connect in more and more meaningful ways. So for all its faults, Twitter is actually an amazing place to connect with people and learn from Black people in tech. So if you're not investing the time and work it requires to reach outside of your circles and hire Black people to work at your company, you are perpetuating the harm in the software development process. So there is a great example of what happens when you diversify your team. Pinterest launched a new feature on their site this year, which allows for a search feature based on skin tone. So their idea behind this was that people who were looking for like hair or skin advice want that advice that are specific to their race or their hair type. And so Pinterest said that the skin tone feature was a direct result of the diversity and inclusion team working hand in hand with technology and engineering. So Pinterest was one of the first tech companies to publicly release annual diversity reports, and they set yearly public hiring goals. And as a result of these efforts, women now make up 47% of their company and 30% of their technical roles in engineering. So this makes it one of the most gender diverse companies in the tech industry. And so their diversity and inclusion team works hand in hand with engineering in building their tools. And this gives more diverse range of voices at the table when they're building things. So whole nations are beginning to set guidelines around how AI should be used. And the industry as a whole really needs to set worldwide standards for how multinational companies will reduce harm. So in April of this year, the EU adopted ethics guidelines for trustworthy artificial intelligence. And at a high level, according to the guidelines, AI should be lawful, respecting of all applicable laws and regulations. It should be ethical, which is respecting ethical principles and values. And it should be robust from a technical perspective, taking into account the social environment. So the guidelines set forward seven key requirements that AI systems should meet in order to be deemed trustworthy. They should have human agency and oversight, technical robustness and safety, privacy and data governance, transparency, diversity, non-discrimination and fairness, societal and environmental well-being, and accountability. So this is just one part of the world. The EU has adopted these guidelines, and they're still evaluating them, and they will be reevaluating them at the end of this year. But the Linux Foundation has actually entered this sphere as well. LFAI is a project whose mission is to build and support open source artificial intelligence and the community, and to drive innovation in this space. So recently, a trusted AI committee was formed underneath LFAI, and it's made up of a number of LFAI members who are committed toward working on open source trusted AI. So the two initial goals of the committee right now are to set AI principles that will hopefully be adopted by the Linux Foundation in the end, and also define some really good case studies and use cases that are out there in the public. I was actually at that meeting this morning where we were talking about that. That's why I missed the morning today, so sorry about that. I'm looking forward to the video though. So let's talk a little bit about what my team at IBM is doing. We are working on a bunch of open source tools that combat bias and increase transparency in AI. The first one is the AI Fairness 360 Toolkit. It's an open source library of metrics that can help you to examine, report, and mitigate bias, and then actual algorithms to help you to actually apply to your data sets to change the outcome. So it's a Python package. It contains a set of algorithms, and we have a bunch of tutorials there, one on credit scoring, one on predicting medical expenditures, and then there is also guidance material on which metrics and algorithms you should use on your, on your specific use case. So yeah, you're going to need guidance. There are over 70 metrics to help you define the problem, and then at least 10 algorithms to actually increase the fairness of your models. And when we're talking about fairness, that's a really hard thing to define. It's multifaceted, it's dependent on context, it's defined by social constructs, so fairness in one country is different from fairness in another. And so our toolkit really helps you with achieving justice in many situations, but it really can't fully capture fairness all the time. This process requires you to have intense discussion with your stakeholders, give them the ability to have input throughout your development process. And so this toolkit really only works if you have a very well-defined problem that you're trying to solve. And you also need to know exactly when you can intervene into the process. Ideally, you're going to have data that you had a hand in collecting, and you were intentional in what kinds of things you were looking for and what labels you have. But if you're working with an open data set or something like that, you might need to use this toolkit to help you with making changes. So if you can modify the training data, you can use pre-processing algorithms. If you're able to change the learning algorithm that you're using, then you're making the change in the in-processing section of machine learning pipeline. And then if you can only treat the learned model as like a black box without any ability to modify it or anything like that, then post-processing can be used. So this is when you're changing the data after it's kind of spit out from the model. And so obviously I recommend the earliest mediation category that you can, because that means you have a really well-defined problem and you know exactly what your output is. And then all permissible categories, all the algorithms that you can use would be best, because that gives you the ultimate performance. But there is really no one answer to any specific problem. So you can play with these algorithms on our website. We actually have the data set that ProPublica used for the COMPAS recidivism scores. So you can actually apply our algorithms to that data set to make the outcomes more fair. And so it's really fun to play around with. If I had more time, I'd do a demo, but I'm a little tight now. But everything you need is available on GitHub as well. So you can also contribute to the project. So for example, when we pushed the toolkit live, we had 9 algorithms baked in there. And within the first week, we had a 10th that was contributed by the community. So we welcome your contributions. So transparency around the data and the models that you're using could help to identify bias as well. With open source deep learning models, you have the ability to see and contribute to the processing of the data. And so this is where I want to talk about our model asset exchange that my team put together. So without something like this, a collection of deep learning models, if you want to get started with deep learning in your applications, you have to do quite a bit of work to get going. So first you do a Google search for, let's say you want to do some image classification, and you get 100,000 results, and you have to read lots and lots of papers and decide which one you're going to use. And then once you find the paper that you want, you need to find an implementation. So after that, now you need to verify your model. So if you work for a commercial organization, you probably have some restrictions around what licensing you can apply. So you need to know, you need to figure out what licenses are available for each one. Then you need to train your model. And so a Tesla K80 GPU can only train about 50 images a second. So this might be okay if you have an existing model and you're doing some transfer learning on some new training data. But if you have a custom model that you've built from scratch, this could take weeks or months to finish, unless you have like a quantum computer or something that's running it for you. Then you need to figure out which framework are you going to use to train your model. And there are many different options out there with different pros and cons to each. And then now that your model's trained, you need to figure out how to deploy it. And you'll probably want to package it up and put it on a server somewhere. And then finally, you're ready to consume your model. So my team at IBM is working on simplifying this process for you so that you really don't need to be a deep learning expert to take advantage of this technology in your apps. So with the Model Asset Exchange, you don't need to be a data scientist or mathematician to take advantage of open source AI. All you need is Docker installed to run these things. And we have over 30 models that you can play with. The models range from audio classification to image segmentation, natural language processing, all that kind of stuff. It's really fun. We've also vetted all the licenses for the code, to ensure that it's enterprise friendly for you as well. So it's important to mention that, you know, the model asset exchange doesn't solve the problem of bias in AI by itself. For example, we have a text sentiment model, for example, that has a lot of the same biases that we saw on the Google Natural Language API, actually. And while we're playing with the AI Fairness 360 model to apply to that model and see how we can fix it, the benefit of using open source is that you understand why that bias is there, you know where the data is coming from, and you can actually contribute to solving the problem instead of, you know, just kind of dealing with a proprietary system that's closed. So it doesn't solve the problem of cognitive bias in AI as a whole, but it does open the door towards collaboration. So I just also want to quickly mention the data asset exchange. We recently released this. It's a library of data sets that are also vetted, and you can see the licensing really easily, and so tap into that. So before I finish, I just want to remind you of the Gender Shades Project one more time. You can do a few things to support this work and work like it. The work proves that being publicly accountable, being held publicly accountable is really key towards fixing these issues. Companies really must work with academia to reduce harm caused by modern technology. So you can volunteer time with the Algorithmic Justice League, which is Joy's organization that she started. They have a sign-up form on their website where you can volunteer to actually test software and build inclusive training sets. There's also ways to report bias in data and submit your data sets to be checked by their volunteers. You can also support Joy's work directly. She has a Patreon, and you can get updates on her projects and, you know, stay on top of what she's doing. I think she's great. So in conclusion, we need to contend with the fact that data is generated based on human behavior, and algorithms and models are built by humans. So no matter what, as technology practitioners, it's our responsibility to build fit systems that are fair. So no one that built any of the projects I mentioned today meant to harm anyone. At least I like to think that they didn't. But they did, and these projects continue to harm people. And so it's our responsibility to stop it. So whether this means making better decisions when building these tools, pushing for legislation to protect our privacy and freedom, or working towards building a more inclusive work environment, we all have a role in this fight for justice. So thank you.